Welcome to CPF Fire Wire, a podcast from California professional firefighters where we discuss a wide range of issues affecting firefighters, our unions, our families, and the communities we serve.
Hello and welcome to another edition of the CPF Fire Wire. I'm CPF President Brian Rice. As firefighters, we're all too familiar with the risks and the stress associated with our job. We all know that these risks are taking their tolls in ways many can't imagine. Firefighters are currently four times as likely to die of suicide as they are from a traumatic line of duty death. It is a health and safety crisis for our profession. This past month, fire departments up and down California observed a safety stand down for behavioral health and suicide awareness. Today on the Firewire, we're going to do something a little different, and one of our brothers is going to tell you his own story in his own words. Matt Fiorenza is a firefighter paramedic with the City of Anaheim Fire Department, and he's been on the job for about two decades and is part of the paramedic crew that responds into Disneyland. Like many of our fellow firefighters, the effects of the job built up over time and pushed him to the breaking point. Matt's journey and his road back to health is an inspiring story that I know will resonate with many of us. Brothers and sisters, in his own words, Anaheim firefighter Matt Fiorenza.
Looking back now, I can tell you, yeah, this is what was happening to me. At the time, I didn't realize. I thought what I was experiencing was just how I was. I didn't understand. I didn't know what PTS was. That was something that soldiers got over there. Firefighters didn't get that. My name is Matt Fiorenza. I'm an Anaheim firefighter. I've been on the job almost 19 years. I'm also on the paramedic unit that responds into Disneyland every day. And I'm on the peer support team. I also am a shepherd for Save a Warrior, a non-for-profit intense retreat for combat veterans and first responders. And I work for Simple Recovery First Responder Program. Well, I knew I always wanted to do something in service. My father was a Marine veteran from Vietnam and Orange County Sheriff. I almost joined the Marine Corps and thought about being a police officer. When I was 18 years old, I met a woman whose mother worked for the Forest Service, and she was always talking about base camp and fire camp, and I was kind of in a transition, and I signed up for a class at Mount San Antonio College in Walnut, California, and I remember the fire chief, Bruce Stedman from Alhambra Fire, came in and he popped in a video of the men and women doing the job, and I was hooked. The chance to be of service and serve the community at that level was absolutely, you know, enticing. I love the camaraderie, the family aspect, the fire family aspect of the job, and that being with these other people and having these relationships was like no other career. And also, I like the medical part of it. I really enjoy being a paramedic and helping people in that regard. It's really rewarding, and to do it on stage at Disneyland is really, really special. I made sure that I put myself on the busy side of town because I wanted to go to paramedic school, and I wanted to be busy, and I wanted to learn everything I could about the job, and I knew the only way to do that was to put myself on the west end of Anaheim, where it's very busy. But I do remember a couple years in when the novelty wore off, when the things that I saw really started to affect me, and I really didn't know how to process that. There's one night that I remember where it was just one bad, horrible call after the next. We had a shooting where a man tried to rob another man. I remember walking in to the scene and just seeing a big trail of blood and a gun. And PD telling us not to step here and don't step there. And there was one way in and one way out of this particular scene. And the guy who was killed was jammed up against that door. So every time we were in and out of that door, we were moving the body. And it was just, it started off that way. And it ended after a really long night of being busy. It ended with a 15-year-old and two stillborn twins. That's one of the nights that stays stuck, if you will. It was a long night. After paramedic school, I had a few really gnarly calls involving kids. I remember doing a critical incident stress debriefing after a woman's boyfriend had run over their 2-year-old. And I remember looking down at this child and seeing the diapers, being the same diapers my son wears or wore at the time. And man, that really affected me. The culture back then, and you know, the idea was that we're going to go do this debriefing. You know, you may or may not see someone cry, and if they do, they got talked bad about at the station afterwards, and you went through the motions, you did what you had to do, and then you got back to the station and you got back on the rig and you went and ran calls like it didn't bother you. And that was the culture. And then in the morning, you met up at the bar and had a beer, you know, where that just got me into trouble. When everybody met for a beer at the bar, I was the last one to leave. You know, when everybody could leave after a few, I stuck around. I really started getting depressed. I was really starting to fall into this depression. The things that I like doing, my hobbies, hanging out with the family, it just, I didn't want to do those things anymore. I started getting really anxious. The anxiety was so bad. I went through a divorce during the time where it was really, really bad. And that was even more stress. I would have panic attacks. I would go to work and talk people down off these panic attacks and tell them to breathe and do all these things I would do as a paramedic, but I couldn't talk myself out of them. And in that time, my back started hurting. I just knew that something wasn't right. And I blamed the job. It was like this weird codependency thing. It was like, this is supposed to be the best job in the world. I love it. I worked so hard to get here. And now, like, I cringe when the tones go off and I don't want to be here. And I really don't want to be on this planet anymore. And that's when things got scary. Around the time my back really started hurting, and the thoughts of not being able to do the job anymore and going through the divorce, and I really started a downward spiral where the ideation kicked in. And I thought that if I can't do this, what else am I going to do? And I really couldn't get away from the thoughts of killing myself. I actually, we had a bad night at work. When I say bad, just busy. It was really busy. My partner came in the morning and said, "Hey, we got a call." And I said, "I can't get up out of bed." I had sent one of my discs so far down into my spinal column that I couldn't move. The doctor said that, you know, I had a choice, but I didn't. He's like, we can hope this goes away with some physical therapy, but you're going to have surgery at some point. Fast forward, I had the surgery. It was painful and it was a long recovery. I pushed it a little bit too hard. I went back within 4 months and within a couple shifts, my back was killing me. I was going through some more divorce stuff. Now, mind you, during that time, I lost everything. I lost my car. I lost time with my children, and I was going back to court. I had to rent a car, and this muscle car is all they had left to rent to go to court one day. So I went to court. I wasn't really happy with the decision the judge made in regards to my children, and so my best thinking put me in that muscle car at a bar that night. Getting drunk and trying to drive home 106 miles per hour down the 5 freeway. I was pulled over by CHP that night. And, you know, back then with my massive ego and, you know, I just thought they're not going to give me a ticket. You know, I'm a firefighter. Don't you know who I think I am? And they did. They pulled me out and they hooked me up, and those men saved my life. After that happened, I got back in the car. I lost it that night. I ended up in a parking lot in Southern California in San Juan Capistrano, where my plan was to make enough noise and to beat this car up enough to have the Orange County Sheriffs respond. And when they did, my plan was to say all the right things and make all the right moves to get them to shoot me. And that was my plan. That was my way out. Instead of getting two sheriffs to kill me that night, I got two of the coolest Orange County sheriffs on the department. They talked me down and allowed me to go home. When I ended up at home, I got surrounded by some of the guys with our local. My girlfriend at the time called my captain, called the union president, and they got me in to see a clinician from the Counseling Team International. She suggested that I might want to check out a 5.5-day program called Save a Warrior for combat veterans and first responders with PTS who are considering suicide. I spent that 5.5 days. I waited a month to go there. I spent that 5.5 days. I in that time, with those men, realized that I wasn't crazy. That childhood trauma on top of moral injury equals complex PTS. And I was able to process some of the childhood stuff. And when I left Save a Warrior, I had a plan to get better. And they pointed me in the direction of recovery. For me, it's different for everybody. For me, I had to get sober. And that was the first step. So after a month of trying to build up enough courage, I walked into my first 12-step meeting. That was August 23rd of 2017. And I now have 2 years sober. I'm heavily involved in two 12-step programs. I have a couple mentors, and I mentor other men through this process. And that's kind of how my journey just began. I was in between these trapezes of not knowing if I had a job on the fire department anymore, trying to recover my back, trying to recover mentally. Those men taught me how to meditate, which was a game changer for me. It's something that I take very serious, and I still do today. I made it back to work, and it was a day at a time when I got back to work. And then slowly, people saw the change. And I felt compelled, for whatever reason, to start sharing my story around the station. I was asked by the clinician that I immediately saw after the wheels fell off. Now she's a colleague, and she started calling me and asking me, can you teach this person meditation? Can you talk to this person? You mind sitting down with this person? And I had no problem doing that. I spent most of my days off talking to other first responders that were struggling. And then I started volunteering with Save a Warrior and going back as a warrior-led organization, which means it's one person who's been through the program helping the next person through. The 100% most effective way for us to heal is peer-to-peer. There aren't too many people out there, unless you've done the job, that know what we experience. You know, we are a family, and it's just taking that family aspect to another level. Being able to reach out to another family member, if you will, and share your experience and get some Me Toos in there, it's really, really, really effective. I wouldn't, and I didn't in the past. You know, I tried the different avenues of getting help, and nothing was as effective as my own brothers and sisters in service. And then I see it, like I said, at being involved with Save a Warrior and the peer-to-peer warrior-led organization, and having one person say, This is where I was at. This is what I went through. This is the job I did, and this is where I at today. This is where I'm at today, and this is how I got here. It is by far the most effective, and I see it working out there, and it works in my own in my own life. We take these careers to be of service. Well, this is an opportunity for us to be of service to each other and make each other feel safe. And that's, we'll go on calls and we'll run into the burning buildings and we'll protect each other that way. It's time we start protecting each other in the firehouse. We have probably about 20 on our peer support team. We have new folks. We have some people that have only been on the job a couple of years. We have some folks that have been here for a long time that have been working in critical incident stress debriefing for a long time, are really good at it, and some folks in the middle. And we also have some of our retired folks that are on our peer support team. So we try to make it real diverse so that anybody who is struggling will have somebody who they feel comfortable talking to. We've used the Healing Our Own tools and the videos for our stand down for suicide just recently. We've gone out to the stations and we let them know that, number one, if you're feeling this way, it's normal. Number two, we have all kinds of resources to help you from A to Z, and that all you gotta do is find somebody you're comfortable with and ask for help, and that's okay. At all the different levels of how people are feeling and the different ranks, I think when it comes to this subject, it doesn't matter. I think we're all first responders and we're all firefighters, and there are times when we struggle and we might not be really aware that that's what's going on, and you just need other people who are well versed in what's in trauma, what happens to our brains and all this stuff, to just get out there and start teaching the young folks. I think that's where we start. Some of the older folks, you know, they're not ready to hear it, and that's okay. We're here for them too. But at the end of the day, I think we're making really, really good strides to bring mental health into our new folks and the people that are coming into the fire service today, and just telling them, hey, if you have a bad day, or if you're struggling, just let us know. Here are the people, and we'll get through it. We'll get you on the other side of it so that you can have a healthy career that you deserve for what you do for our communities. We're not superheroes. We're human beings that do some pretty amazing things out there in our community, and it's okay. It's okay to struggle. It's okay to open up. And it's okay to ask for help, because there's a solution. And once they do that, then we can get on the other side of any of this stuff and have some really, really good days and enjoy our careers. From my own experience, I was able to get to a point where I asked for help. And talking to those clinicians and working with other people who struggle themselves, they were able to get me on the other side of it. And it didn't end my career. I stuck it out. I put in a lot of work to stay mentally healthy, and it's worth it because I have a good career. I have a lot of opportunities now, and I have a really good life, and I could be a dad and a good fireman.
Since we recorded this conversation, Matt's been helping other firefighters find their way back from post-traumatic stress and its effects. He remains an important part of Anaheim's peer support team. Matt has helped develop a first responder wellness program through Simple Recovery, an Orange County-based recovery center, and he has told his story to fire academies and community colleges throughout Southern California. Matt's efforts are helping to bring behavioral health and post-traumatic stress out of the shadows in our profession. During last month's suicide stand down, departments and locals conducted exercises and had difficult conversations about suicide in the fire service. If you're having thoughts of suicide, don't suffer in silence. Get help. The National Suicide Prevention Lifeline number is 1-800-273-8255. Again, that number is 1-800-273-8255. You can also find resources and information and stories like Matt's at healingourown.org. Thank you for listening, and join us soon for another edition of the CPF Firewire.
You can find CPF Firewire at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Podbean, or wherever you find podcasts. Be sure to subscribe so you'll never miss an episode. You can also find CPF Firewire at the CPF website, www.cpf.org, and on the CPF YouTube page. We're always interested in getting your feedback, comments, and criticism. Tell us what you'd like to hear about. Drop us a line. info@cpf.org. CPF Firewire is a production of California Professional Firefighters. Our producer is Carol Wills. Our engineer is Matt McDermott. Please join us next month for another edition of CPF Firewire.